three. Yes!
Here's quick release three.
Got it! And it's good! Another Friday night here at the Luke Urban Fieldhouse tonight. Boys versus Somerset Berkeley. Hello again, everybody. I'm Evan Massoud alongside Brendan Kelly for our Friday night basketball coverage from Durfee High School. Brendan, Somerset coming in. They've already beaten Durfee once this season. That was back on December 13th, game two of the year. And Durfee made a run at the end of that one, but a slow start really plagues them. 7-3 Somerset coming into tonight.
Yeah, Somerset's off to a great start at the halfway point, especially in a very solid SEC this year. SEC top to bottom is good basketball in this area right now. So Somerset's coming in, you know, hungry.
The Raiders have lost two of their last three, but their last game was a victory, and that was against Dighton Rehoboth earlier this week. For Durfee, they've hit a bit of a skid. They've lost three in a row, all in conference play. That's a little bit worrisome as we hit the halfway mark.
Yeah, I said it a couple weeks ago when we did this. The SEC is beyond balance, and every team's going to have to be ready to play every single night, and Durfee's seeing that.
The real killer was last Friday, a tough night for both the girls and the boys squad. We saw the girls get hit with their first loss of the season last Friday. The boys were in New Bedford and blew an 11-point lead in the fourth. They were outscored 19-5 in the last 8 minutes, lost by three.
Yeah, New Bedford is New Bedford. Ultimate respect for our old Big Three Conference playing up there. Durfee's got their hands full tonight. They're going to have to be ready to play right from the jump.
We talk about strength of schedule a lot. You know, we're seeing in the conference games some struggles for Durfee, but that's where you're seeing the D1 opponents. We don't see a lot of D1 opponents around here. I know we've talked about it on previous broadcasts before, and I think that sometimes you're seeing some of the fault there, you know, not seeing all D1 all the time.
Yeah, it's challenging with this new power ranking system. You know, in our area, there's only a certain amount of D1 teams, you know, unless you're willing to travel all around the state. You know, you play your area, and you know, Durfee's seeing, you know, the D1 talent that's out there right now.
Well, tonight, Somerset not to be taken lightly. They are from right across the river. It's a good rivalry game, and yes, they're a lower division, but this is always a great matchup. So we hope you'll stick around. Live coverage is next on Fred TV.
I'm Mike LaBossiere, what's up, a reservation forester.
And I'm Paul Ferland, the administrator of community utilities.
Protecting open space is a benefit today, and it's a gift to future generations.
For over 150 years, Fall River has been a leader in environmental preservation. The Southeastern Massachusetts Bioreserve ensures forests and fields remain undeveloped and accessible. The Community Preservation Act is a vital component to fulfill climate goals.
Since 2017, CPA funds totaling nearly $1.3 million have been used to acquire conservation areas in Fall River. Educational programs within the bioreserve connect families to nature and promote understanding and respect for diverse culture, history, and wildlife.
Half of Fall River, about 12,000 acres, an area the size of Mattapoisett, is protected water and woodland. Healthy forests minimize flooding, reduce erosion, and provide habitat for endangered species.
As the region expands manufacturing and technology, people are directly reliant on green infrastructure as an irreplaceable source of clean water and air.
Miles of trails wind through unique landscapes which appeal to hikers, cross-country skiers, and mountain bikers. Specific areas are open for safe seasonal hunting. The bioreserve promises endless discoveries and recreational experiences year-round.
CPA funds have supported thousands of significant projects in Massachusetts. Thank you for your continued interest in community beautification and betterment.
Welcome back, everybody, inside the Luke Urban Fieldhouse. Evan Massoud and Brendan Kelly with you. We've got a pretty packed house here on this Friday night, Friday, January the 20th, and I don't know what we're going to do or what I'm going to do. I haven't really had a true Friday off since football season, and we do not have Friday night basketball for the next two Fridays after tonight, so kind of going to be strange to have a Friday night off.
Yeah, this is, and here we are. I mean, three quarters of the way through January. This is about the halfway point for most teams. It's moving fast. So there'll be a nice break for you going into the February stretch.
Yeah, and don't be mistaken, folks. It doesn't mean we don't have games. It's just not Friday. Next week, a little bit lighter. We only have two games on the schedule. Boys Hoops from Diamond. We'll see the Bengals boys for the first time. And then we will see the boys back here, Durfee boys. The BR game got rescheduled, which was supposed to be on, it was supposed to be this Tuesday. So Durfee has not played in a week, but the game against BR here is next Thursday. And we added that one into the schedule because we had nothing Thursday. So a rare Thursday night game next week as well from the field house. Brendan, as we get started, you want to take the I'll take Somerset, you take Durfee, okay?
Sounds
we'll
good.
Start with Somerset, the 7-3 Raiders. Starters for SB. Number 14, Brendan McDonald. Number 15, Finian Bjork. Number 21, Mason Medeiros. Number 22, Drew McGarry. And number 23, William Dion. Head coach for Somerset, Bob Slater, in his 14th season.
For Durfee, number 22, senior Alexis Montilla at center. Number 23, senior Jaleel Simmons. Number 5, Eric Lucas at one guard. Number 2, Devontae Stewart at the other guard and the point guard. Number 3, Jaden Espino. They're going with their traditional lineup, which they've had for most of the season.
Of course, Joe DeCruz, the head coach for Durfee.
Year number four.
Four, right?
Year number four for Coach DeCruz, yeah.
Four already. You know, where's time gone, I'll tell you. Espinal, quick three, wants to answer, does not get it to go. The rebound to Bjork, who opened the scoring with the three on this other side.
On the Durfee side, Jaden Espinal, two quick threes. He's trying to get himself going. He's a shooter, wants to try to see one fall right away. He's 0 for 2, but both are good shots.
Thrown away. Well, you know that when you lose a game like last week against New Bedford, if you're Durfee, what you want is to get right back out there. And they've had to sit for a week. It's tough to not have a game for a week.
Yeah, you look at it two different ways. In one way of looking at it is what you just said. You lose a tough one at New Bedford, traditional rival. Always emotional every time you play New Bedford. You do want to get back there. But not a bad thing at this point of the season. Kind of get your legs, get your mind right.
A little extra rest.
Brendan McDonald for three right off the jump.
So that comes to a point, though, right? So, you know, when you see a baseball team that doesn't play for a week, they always say, you know, timing goes off with the swing and the pitches and whatnot. Is it the same with basketball, having that full week off, or is the rest actually a good thing?
Again, it all depends. I've been in situations where I've coached and played, and you want to play every day.
Yeah.
You're hot. The ball's going in. The rim seems like it's a million feet wide. Mm-hmm. You want to play every day. And then there's other times where school, the month of January, things maybe aren't going your way. A little time in between games to get your mind right, get your body right isn't a bad thing. So it all depends on the situation here, and it might have been both ways for Durfee.
You know, an interesting one, you know, Somerset's already played 10. When we were at Diamond this week for the girls' game, the Bengals played Tri-County. Tri-County already had played, I believe, more than 10 games, or that was their 11th game. I said, geez, we're only a month in. So they're going to be kind of light going down the stretch with, you know, about 6 weeks left. That might be good for them to get a little bit of rest.
Yeah, I always had a tough time with, do you want to pack up your schedule early in December, try to get off to a good spot, ride that confidence, or do you want to, where maybe, you know, you're hitting your peak later in the season, have more games there. I don't know if there's a right or wrong answer or what I've liked. I've done it both ways, but, you know, you can definitely tell. Sometimes it's just scheduling. ADs can schedule, they can schedule, and that's that.
Durfee off to a very, very, very cold shooting right now. Nothing's going in.
No, nothing's going in. So now it's time to start crashing the boards and finding an open lane to the basket, because the free shots here from the field are not working in the first almost half a quarter here as we're coming up on 4:30. We just had our first foul of the game on the floor. That was Drew McGarry picking it up for Somerset. Espinal with the rebound, but Somerset has numbers. There's a nice take. Even that doesn't go. Does get the rebound, so he was there to help himself out, and the Hilltoppers are finally on the board. But to your point, slow start, and now a timeout. Coach DeCruz calling the timeout. First one for the game for either side.
Good timeout by Coach DeCruz. It's so early, and we've spoken of this before. You want instant success, and you want to see things going early, and you see the first four or five shots not going, and even that layup, you needed two opportunities for it.
Yeah.
This is a timeout to just settle these guys in. It's super early in the game. Also, you got to get out on McDonald. He's one of the best players in the area. He's only a sophomore, and he will let it fly, and he can make them. He's already made one. He's already had cleaner looks than you probably should in the first quarter. So that's probably two things that he's saying is, stay the course, super early, shots are going to fall, but better get out on McDonald. Make it a little hotter for him right now.
Well, that was a quick timeout, as you said, just a kind of rally the troops for a minute, calm yourselves down, make quality shots, you know, all the standards, I guess you could say, right, if there's such a thing, all the standards.
This being the first time I've seen Somerset play, they're definitely a lot bigger than I was anticipating them, and we spoke before with Coach Slater. They're young. There's only two seniors on their roster. They play. They start two sophomores, three juniors, and they've had some success. The SEC is very good, top to bottom, right now. And you know, having coached in that league, you know, 14 game schedule is good basketball. McDonald with another look right now. He's not afraid to let it fly.
McGarry got the rebound, and now Somerset does come away with it. Dion gets it. It was a good defensive stand for Durfee, but even better, Somerset's ball movement, passing game makes me think of Jeff Caron or Billy Shea or Matt Kurt type of style. Very quick, in and out of the hands and moving it so quickly around the perimeter that, you know, as a defense, you're kind of scrambling back and forth. Espinal puts up another, in and out. Devontae Stewart with the rebound. Can't get it to go. Foot race to the ball, and Medeiros will come away with it.
Right now, I definitely think Somerset, from a pace standpoint, is, like you just said, everything's crisper right now. Their passes, their ball movement, they're attacking the glass a little bit stronger, getting their hands on things. Durfee needs to pick it up a little bit on that end. And that's stuff that has absolutely nothing to do from a game plan, instead, that's just effort.
Long three for Durfee, no good from Lucas. Kicks off the rim right to McDonald, who goes coast to coast. No basket, rebound to Medeiros. Corner wide open, doesn't go. Oh my gosh,
both guys went down, but I do think that there was a break in the fall. Well, Devontae Stewart and Drew McGarry, I think initially it looked a lot worse than it was and or could have been, but that was two guys in the air.
Well, McGarry, the way his head bumped back, I thought he hit the rim with his head, to be quite honest with you. His head just snapped back away from the rim. Kind of dangerous.
Luckily, both guys broke their fall. They seem to be all right at the free throw line.
That foul on William Dion, the second for Somerset. Simmons at the line, misses the first.
Avante Lamore in the game right now. He's been instant offense. He's had really put together a nice first half of the season, started a few games. He's got some big games. He has four or five games in double figures. Right now, they're definitely going to look at him, see if they can get this lid off the hoop.
Here's a comparison for you. Lamore makes me think of whenever you subbed in Paulina Feitelberg, you needed a quick three, you went to Paulina, and you got it. You got more than one, and that's what Lamore makes me think of for the boys here this year. He's been a spark off the bench.
That's a great cop. There were a lot of times that specific season, and Paulina played 3 years on the varsity, but that specific season you're talking about, there were so many times she would come in, the entire gym would yell, "Shooter."
Yeah, you're right.
Coaching staff, players, the entire gym, wherever we were, and she would hit her first shot on her first touch.
No, it's serious. I mean, that was always, as soon as you'd bring her, if she wasn't starting, I said, okay, here we go.
Yeah, it was great. That was her junior year where she would come in. And I remember the first game of the year, I think she was something like 6 for 6 or 7 for 7.
That was Bree's senior year, right?
Brianna was only a sophomore that year.
Oh, Paulina was older?
Paulina was a year older.
Oh, my gosh. I don't remember that. Okay. Well, there you go.
The year.
They're all blending, Brendan.
When we talk
10 years of it, they're all blending.
When we talk about, you know, former players of mine being colleagues,
yeah.
Both of them a year ago were colleagues.
Right.
Working at Durfee High School. It's great to get, you know, former Hilltoppers back in the teaching game and working in the building. So
absolutely.
That was funny. Good timeout by Coach Slater. Again, trying to settle everything down because Somerset's not shooting particularly well. 2 minutes to go. We're in closeout time of the quarter. It's only 6-5. Neither team shot the ball well at all.
No, I think there was that kind of false sense of, oh boy, offensive start because Somerset started with 3 balls back-to-back. But since then, Durfee's had the last 5. So really, a 6-0 run for Somerset and now a 5-0 run for the Hilltoppers.
Just the way basketball is going right now, the fact that you shoot so many three-pointers at all levels, it looks great, it works great. You know, 3s are worth more than 2, but when they're not falling, this is what we get right now, almost a quarter of high school basketball in 6-5, but things even itself out.
When they're not falling, 0 points versus 2 gets you nothing, so you got to find different ways to score. That foul against McDonald in the transition on Espinal's steal there, if you will, and it was on the floor, no free throws, but 3 fouls for Somerset. Interestingly enough, as we come up on a minute 15, no fouls for Durfee in this first quarter. That is something we have not seen. McDonald for 3, and it's no good.
Well, there's no fouls because nobody's taking the ball to the basket, and when you shoot the ball far away, the rebounds are typically far away, so you don't even have those opportunities to get the rebound.
True.
And get close ones, so there's no fouls there. As we speak, Somerset called for a charge, blocking foul.
Mm.
They say he was going up around the floor. Looks like it'd be under the basket.
Dion's second foul. Coach Slater not happy with that call. For a minute, I thought it was offensive, the way the player went down. I thought they were going to call it against Durfee. Long 3 for Simmons is good. Tie game. Under a minute.
Both teams defensively are just packing it in. Right now, they both look like they're gonna wait and see who gets hot. Neither team is shy about shooting three-pointers. This has been a lot of three-pointers. If we had an official stat person right now, I bet you we're well over 10 combined three-point attempts. I think easy.
Yeah, absolutely. Off the foot.
The pace hasn't been, I mean, it's been a fast quarter, but the pace hasn't been fast on the floor. Both coaches are letting them fly.
McGarry coming back in. Two and a half second differential between the shot clock and the game clock. Game clock has a little extra time on it, but Durfee can try to run it down a bit. Rarely do we see a team truly hold. We haven't really seen that much at all this year. Lamore puts it up and in for 3.
There's your Paulina Feidelberg reference. First time touched the ball right in the corner. Hold Jim Sain, shooter, hits one smooth.
Durfee, after being down 6-0, closes out the quarter on an 11-2 run, and they lead it by 3 after 8 minutes.
And taking back the 2 first shots that Somerset hit, that were 2 3-point buckets, Durfee shot a little bit better than Somerset.
Second quarter about to begin here at Durfee. Somerset will have possession. Brendan, go for it.
I apologize. Talk about closing out. Durfee did a good job with a couple three balls, a couple rebounds. Turned a quarter that wasn't very, very good into a nice little quarter lead to start. Stewart with the rebound. And this is where Durfee can start getting some buckets to go in right now if they take care of the ball. Somerset's at a very high 3-2 zone, which you don't see typically right now. So test with Durfee's gut on the stick, gut on the scout, and how they're going to execute their offense and making them think a little bit. 8 seconds on the shot clock. And a deflection.
And, yep, out of bounds.
Durfee has 5 on the shot clock. Plenty of time to get a good look. Run their out of bounds plays. Montilla to the basket, strong and fouled. He'll go to the line, 4-2. Montilla misses the first. A little break in the action here at Durfee. Misses the second.
That foul was on Maxwell Finlow, the fifth for Somerset.
Somerset miss again, long rebound. Neither team is trying to pick the pace up by pressing after makes or misses, but when shots are not falling, it's tough to get into your press. But Somerset very keen on just getting back, playing very tough. They get their defense extended a little bit more now. 1-2-2, it looks like. Really going to make Durfee think. Stewart with a corner three and a loose ball foul on Montilla.
Yep, that's going to be Durfee's first foul. We have double zero is out there. We only have a single zero on our roster. I'm assuming it's the same player, Max Finlaw. As I said, he picked up the last foul for Somerset that resulted in the two shots. Durfee's first foul here on the floor, tipped, and Durfee gets it right back. Nice pass to Lamore. The putback from Espinal, no good. Stewart gets it back.
And this is what Devontae Stewart does his best. He's great at cleaning up. He's great at offensive putbacks. This is where he's got to get some of his baskets.
Travel against Somerset.
Finlaw played a little bit in the JV game. Coach Slater definitely taking advantage of the rule that was last year where you can now play 6 quarters on a given night, which I think is fantastic.
That's a lot.
It's a lot, but it really actually helps out coaches.
Yeah.
And, you know, those swing-type plays, you can really do a traditional of both.
Might have been tipped out of the hands there of Simmons. Acrobatic take to the basket. And it looks like Espinal is going to get called on a foul. I don't even see any contact there.
Yeah, McDonald with a great hesitation move and kind of got deep where it was tough for him to finish. You tell McDonald, being the scorer that he is, he's trying to find different ways other than just typically shooting three-pointers. Great way to get to the get a scorer going is get to the free throw line, try to get some easy ones.
He hits the first. Both free throws from McDonald, good, and Somerset on the board here in the second. 13-10 with 6 to go before half. 10 minutes of game time in the books.
Somerset's
tipped.
Game plan is very much so slow Durfee down. Try not to let them get easy ones. I think we just got away with a travel.
Good block out of bounds. Good pressure from Montilla. He forced that out of bounds right there. So a turnover now gives it back to the Hilltoppers.
Somerset again back just on a half-court defense. They're a little bit more extended than they've been. But they are very keen on slowing the game up right now. They seem very comfortable playing at a low scoring pace right now.
Loose ball, Lamore. Baseline flips it up, no good. Stewart up the ladder, Montilla up the ladder. Espinal gets it back, it's no good. And the reach and rebound. They're calling a foul? How is that not dual possession? Two players wrapped around the ball.
I was always against that type of play. It's ultimate hustle from a player. But referees tend to make that as a foul call.
That's garbage.
That far away from the basket. It's one of those instinctive calls that I believe in. It's just tough situation on a hustle play.
It's garbage. That was a jump ball. Stewart had two hands on that ball.
Durfee on the defensive end, a little bit more pep in their step. Somerset also having a tough time.
Now, see, that was a foul there put on by Hoyle, slapping at Stewart on the rebound. He didn't touch that ball. He grabbed Stewart on the wrist. That's a great block, though.
Mason Medeiros for Somerset, very active. He's one of the juniors, very active, a little bit bigger than you think he is. Does a nice job on that nice block.
Durfee will inbound, quick three from Espinal, it's good. Finally got one, he's been trying for it. That one down.
I'll tell you what, the one thing I'm impressed with Espinal is I've watched him for the last 2 years, and he's obviously Durfee's main threat. Last year, a little bit more off the bench, kind of in the Lamore category.
Yeah.
But as a shooter, I'm just very impressed with his body language, and he doesn't really get frustrated. This is the second night that I've seen this year where he doesn't have him falling, but he keeps shooting and he keeps taking good shots. And five in a row right there as we speak, he stays confident and stays positive. I'm very impressed. You don't see that a lot in a high school student, how poised he is. I love his body language. You don't know if he's playing a good game or a bad game. As I say that right now, maybe he does a very good job of hiding some of his comments because both referees talking to both him and Finn Bjork on a little bit of trash talking. So maybe I spoke too soon, but there's nothing wrong with a little energy here. Durfee picking up
Full
court. Somerset just gets the ball over half court.
I was just going to say, that was close. Stewart with the rebound, another miss for Somerset. So the Raiders have gone cold with the shooting here. Only one from the field over the last 10-plus minutes of game time, okay? That tells you where. So the two threes they had to open the game, you know, kind of a bit of a smokescreen in a way. It just padded the stats, but really struggling offensively is Somerset.
Great hustle by Lucas. Try to get that steal in the backcourt. Yeah, you go back to the first two possessions of the game for Somerset, two loud three-pointers. After that, they haven't done much. Lucas a little too aggressive in the backcourt.
Fourth Durfee foul, all four coming here in the second quarter. They had none in the first, and four different players. So I guess one consolation is they're spreading it out a bit. No one in foul trouble. The only player with two in this game is Somerset's William Dion.
That's a great catch by Lucas. It's an even better block by Medeiros.
That's offensive. Not calling it. The three misses. Montilla with the rebound down the court to Stewart. Fouled. Get in that basket. It doesn't go, but Stewart will take two shots.
That's a great pass by Montilla. Great job leaking out by Devontae Stewart. Durfee trying to get out of that zone offense that they're forced to be in play right now. Get nice, easy layups. That's a great way to make that happen.
Monty is just warming up that arm for some right field action in a couple months out on the new Skip Lewis field. That's all.
That looked like that was a base hit to right field, and he was going right to third to throw somebody out.
He's got a heck of an arm, I'll tell you. I was so impressed. The outfield was great last year, but Montilla was... He's a great right fielder. The ground that he can cover and the throwing arm, I mean, very impressive for a high schooler.
He's got a great body for a high school baseball player. He's long. He's lean.
Yeah.
And he can play multiple positions, too. So he's a throwback.
Sure. Now, Lamar lost it. And now a dual possession.
That's a great job by my. And again, this is what he does well, too, these hustle plays. There was no hesitation. Diving on the floor. These are the things that can get Durfee's energy up. And when Durfee's energy's up, shots start falling a little bit more. Yeah, easy possessions, easier possessions, second opportunities. There's a little pep in Durfee's step. You'd like to see that a little earlier, but here we are right now. We want to definitely use it.
Stewart gets a pass in the paint. Underhand flip back to Lucas. Now Lamore in the corner. Back outside to Stewart. Good passing. That one doesn't go. And a tough foul against Stewart. That one you could see reached over. There was contact.
Stewart with his second foul right now. Just about 3 minutes to go in the half.
Durfee's fifth.
Coach DeCruz is going to go with Christopher Milford coming in, the junior, coming to play big minutes right here. I always think these are important minutes right now. Durfee kind of grinding to a 9-point lead right now. We don't want to let Somerset get hot with 3 minutes to go. Really want them thinking in the halftime.
That's the first from the field for Somerset in the second quarter.
Medeiros with a nice finish inside the painted area.
Over 5 minutes, Durfee held them scoreless from the field. That's not bad. Good feed down low, and Durfee going to get it back. Lucas, it's tipped.
This is one of the better sequences, the last handful of possessions I've seen this season of Durfee moving the ball, looking for the extra pass. Matter of fact, they probably passed too many times this pass position, but they're looking for it. And they're more successful when there's 3, 4, 5 touches in a possession.
Travel against Milford.
Trying to attack the basket.
No, I think you're right, though, about the passing, because, you know, traditionally, especially over the last couple years, right, Durfee's had the couple big scorers, and that's what people are going to that's what other teams are going to look for and defend. They're going to look for those couple players, and they're going to try to close them out. So if you're moving the ball and getting contributions from everybody, obviously that's going to make it more difficult on your opponent and your opposing defense.
Yeah, the other thing, too, it's tough. They run primarily a dribble drive, so you think of, you know, the primary options each time is the ball gets stuck, but it'll be Somerset ball on the possession. The primary options are dribble drives and taking the ball to the basket the first couple. The more you can skip the floor, give other guys, that's when they get the easy ones, but they're doing a nice job moving the ball along.
That one well off the mark,
Pacheco
out of bounds.
Way off. Somerset really struggling right now, shooting in the big field house. Defensively, though, Somerset looks very comfortable, just played in the half court. They've got it packed in, running this kind of 1-2-2, 3-2 zone. That I do actually think has a lot to do with Durfee moving the ball around as Lucas gets into the lane.
Gets it back. Espinal, open three. It's good.
Great job by Jaden Espinal. Obviously making the shot. Even better, shooting through a poor first quarter. Not getting in his own head. That's an incredible job as Lucas getting his hands on some things. Gets to the rim. Extends the lead to 12. Timeout, Somerset.
10 points for Espinal, 8 in the quarter. 24-12, the score on a 5-point swing in about 10 seconds. We're sitting with a minute 4 to play in the half.
We talk about the speed being lost last year between Javon Holly and Jaden Lewis. Eric Lucas and Jaden Espinal, I mean, they're not slow. Those guys are fast, so if they can get their hands on some stuff, get out on the open floor, good things are going to happen.
Yeah, I think the key to it is, you know, is Coach DeCruz said, you know, finding the identity. When these guys were not necessarily starters last year for every single game, so they weren't seeing the same minutes. Now they're in there every game, and you're starting to see with more court time, more playing time, more comfort to do these things and make an have an impact.
There's no doubt about it. People think it's easy to go from JV to varsity and just contribute right away, or go from a secondary role to a primary role and just go. It's different. It takes time, mentally, physically, getting your reps and stuff like that. So I think very well said by Coach DeCruz. Now, game 10 right now, you're starting to see guys get a little bit more comfortable. They know day-to-day, game-to-game, what their role is going to be.
Lost the ball, and Lamore going to get called on a foul?
Very late call from across the floor, it looks like right now. Looked like Christopher Milford did a good job picking up the loose ball, but
Milford got the foul.
Late call from the other side of the floor. Very important for Durfee. As my pet saying, closing quarters out right now. They're feeling good about themselves. They don't want to leave Somerset an easy one or two, as Espinal is really feeling hot right now. Milford with a great putback and hustle minutes. That's what Chris does. He comes in. I love his energy. Do the simple things. Big putback. Shot clock's turned off for Somerset.
Final 15 of the half. Well, it's been a tremendous second quarter for the Hilltoppers.
Milford with another deflection. Durfee has the opportunity, and correct me if I'm wrong with this, hold Somerset to just 4 points in the second quarter.
4 points and one from the field. Tipped away, swatted at by Milford. 2-on-1.
Lucas flying up the floor. Great closeout of the quarter by the Hilltoppers. Excellent second quarter by Durfee with a lot of energy and obviously shot making.
17-point second quarter for the Hilltoppers. They hold Somerset to just 4 total points. 1 basket from the field. It was a layup. That's it. Impressive second quarter heading into the break for the Hilltoppers.
Anytime you can hold a high school team to under double digits in both the first and second quarter, good things are going to happen.
Hilltoppers up 16 points at halftime. Great end to this first half after really a slow first quarter. Durfee really picking it up. We're going to take the break here during the half. Brendan and I will be back with the third quarter in just under 10 minutes' time. You're watching live basketball from Durfee on Fred TV.
Hello, I'm Joyce Rodericks, class historian, reporting from the state-of-the-art studio at Fall River Educational Television, known as Fred TV. BMC Durfee High School class of 1962 reunited on October 15th, 2022 at Durfee 3.0 on Ellsbury Street.
60's a big one, and I'm excited to be here. Happy to see everyone. Everyone's smiling. It's wonderful. Yeah.
Our high school on Rock Street opened in 1887, and it is on the National Register of Historic Places. Built of local granite, it is now a probate courthouse. The telescope and bells have been erected at the new school. The bells, officially called a carillon, are iconic symbols of our hometown. Durfee is the only public school in the United States to have a designated carillon. Six decades passed quickly. Admittedly, most of us, including myself, habitually scan social media to look for and share obituaries. But still, the names on the memorial board took our breath away. Members of the National Honor Society led tours, including the athletic complex. 21st century courses are now standard curriculum, such as robotics, pre-engineering, nursing, as well as advanced college placement.
I feel Durfee pride everywhere. Durfee pride, like, is contagious. It really is.
Students in career and technical education prepared lunch at the Granite Grill, a working restaurant open to the public. We exchanged contact information on smartphones. Who could have imagined? We shared memories of glee club and band practice, business and Latin club meetings, astronomy class, and sports championships. Lots and lots of championships. Susan Aldrich Williams donated her cheerleading uniform, which is now on display in the fashion design studio.
It is so pleasing for us gals to see a gym that incorporates the women, the young ladies. When we went to high school, we had to wear our gym clothes, and every woman here knows we had to wear our gym clothes underneath our real clothes, our gym suit. So it really is a lot of fun, and I have followed this thing around with me for 60 years. I am happy to donate it, along with the football sweater, because this was our basketball uniform.
Classmates from Mississippi, Virginia, California, and beyond were in attendance, approximately 80 of us.
I'm just amazed at the beauty around me and just excited when the student just told me that they use the old beams from the mills in Fall River. And I just think that's wonderful to include history in something that's so modern and state of the art.
I wish my friends health and happiness until the next reunion. And to today's Hilltoppers, work hard, be helpful, and may you have the best and brightest futures. I congratulate members of the event committee and thank current staff and students at Durfee. I'm Joyce Rodericks, class of 1962, reporting from Fred TV.
Good morning, yesterday. You wake up and time has slipped away. And suddenly it's hard to find the memories you left behind. Remember, do you remember? The laughter and the tears, the shadows of misty yesteryears, the good times and the bad you've seen, and all the others in between. Remember, you remember the times of your
Fall River Public Schools has opportunities for positions in multiple areas for people looking to work with the next generation. Come grow with our team. We have openings for teachers, paraprofessionals, and teaching assistants, and other educational support positions available. We are also looking to fill operations support positions such as custodial, security, and food service. We offer competitive salary and benefit plans. We have rewarding work available in our 21st century schools and learning environments. Come grow with us. Please contact the Human Resources Department at 508-675-8420, extension 53708, or see our postings on our website at fallriverschools.org.
Hey,
Hello, my name is Laura Ferreira, the Director of Traffic and Parking. During a snowstorm, your safety is our first priority. At times, a parking ban may be necessary to ensure access for emergency vehicles and to allow plows to clear streets. A general rule is park on the side of the street opposite the fire hydrant. For more information, please visit our website at www.fallrivermA.org and search parking ban. In addition, you may call the mayor's office at 508-324-2600 or the Office of Traffic and Parking at 508-324-2123. New England weather can be unpredictable. Notification of a parking ban will be made early to give residents the opportunity to move their vehicles. Thank you for your assistance and cooperation.
The Gothic Revival style arch at Oak Grove Cemetery signals the final resting place of some of Fall River's most prominent residents.
Since 1873, thousands of funeral processions have passed through these ornate iron gates. War heroes, abolitionists, mill owners, and Lizzie Borden are buried within these walls.
Despite fine craftsmanship and historical recognition, the arch was unable to withstand time and the elements, and was in danger of collapse.
10 years ago, Fall River residents voted to adopt the Community Preservation Act, which allows for a 1.5% surcharge on property tax bills. This cherished landmark was saved with funds through the Community Preservation Act.
In just 5 months, this time using some modern machinery, local contractors refurbished the granite arch and replaced sections of the gate.
A uniquely Fall River work of art and a respectful reflection for the dead has been saved for future generations.
CPA funds have supported thousands of significant projects in Massachusetts. Thank you for your continued interest in community beautification and betterment.
Welcome back, everybody, to the Luke Urban Fieldhouse. It is the third quarter. And the Hilltoppers start with points.
Taking that energy from the second quarter right into the third quarter. Espinal gets right in. Nice little dish off to Stewart for two. Nice easy bucket for Devontae.
And now Stewart's going to get hit with a foul. His third foul. First for the team here in the third.
That's a tough foul for Devontae. Three. Early in the third quarter, he's going to have to be the leader that he is. He's going to have to play with three fouls.
Well, the good news is they're up by 18 right now. So a little bit of room. Keep padding the lead. Don't have any wasted possessions. And, if he ends up fouling out, you hope that it's not closer. Hopefully the lead is bigger.
Quick timeout by Coach Slater. Durfee with two quick baskets.
Lucas with the long ball, a 5-0 start here in the first 51 seconds of the third.
This is big for Durfee. We go back to what we were talking about before. Three tough league games that didn't go in the favor of Durfee. Durfee is in dire need of a real confidence booster. And after that first quarter, they've really, really been flying on all cylinders right now. They've got to keep this positive momentum going up right now. Getting to game, this is game 10, second half of the season's upon us.
Mm-hmm.
They really, really, really need the confidence.
Well, this is a team that lost to Somerset back on December 13th. Final score of 73-68, but it really wasn't that close at halftime. It was a big deficit for Durfee. They made a surge at the end, but too little too late. Tonight, they were not going to get caught down by, say 15 or 20 points. Now they're up by 21.
Yeah, they've got to keep, moving forward, keep the energy up. They've got to play under control. All basketball teams have a tendency when things stop falling like they are, they get a little excited, and they're going to have to watch out for McDonald too.
McDonald had a three
in the first. It was the second three that Somerset had to give them a 6-0 lead. Just to put it in perspective, that three from McDonald's right now was just the third shot from the field that went down since the opening 2 or 3 minutes of this game. So it shows you the struggles Somerset has had offensively and the defense that Durfee's been putting out there.
Somerset's not shy about shooting threes, so
no. So
remember, they're worth more than twos, and up 20 is not what it used to be.
No, not at all.
Watch any level of basketball, the point swings can go fast, so while this is nice, Durfee built up a 21-point lead, they've got to keep doing good things or that'll evaporate really fast.
Nice play there by Dion. He missed the opportunity for a shot. The ball came loose, got it back, and then sent it off of one of the Hilltoppers.
Great side out by Somerset with a little lob play. A little bit further down, too. That wasn't right under the basket, so that was a tough pass he had to make.
That's Stewart's fourth. He got hit on that foul as well. He's up to four now. He's going to end up having to take a seat.
No movement on the bench right now, which...
Excuse me, Stewart picked up his, I missed it. Stewart picked up one before that. This is Durfee's third. So Stewart now already with four, and now Simmons picking up his first. So there was another foul.
I think correction-wise, and again, I'm not good at this stuff with watching the game and doing stats. I think Devontae only has three, that foul being on Simmons right now. He picked up that one earlier on. I don't believe it's
okay on
his. I think every game we do,
we're
way off on Devontae Stewart's.
I know.
One of my favorite players to watch, one of my favorite kids in school. I enjoy having him in class. I love the way he plays. We screw up his foul situation. This is the second night in a row.
I know, right?
Where Simmons just picked up another one.
So Simmons with his second, but Stewart had, I saw them put up the third, and then it said four fouls before Simmons. And the team has four, so there's one that's unaccounted for. I think Stewart picked up a fourth away from the ball. We'll have to see.
Well, hopefully we're wrong because the coaching staff doesn't have somebody ready to run in, so.
Yeah, I mean, I would imagine that with Stewart, if he had four, and he would not be in the game right now.
Somerset, even down double figures, they're going to stay packed in right now. They're going to stick to their game plan.
Picked up by Montilla after it kicked off of one of the Raiders' shoes. That's a travel. Oh, they're calling the foul.
Durfee's going to stay under control and do exactly what got them to this point. It's natural reaction to want to try to go a little bit hotter, try to go a little bit fancier, a little bit more physical, and this is what's happening right now. The pace of play is slowed down now because there's a lot of ticky-tack fouls on Durfee. Durfee picking up five fouls, and none of them have been going to the basket and or stopping a basket. So this is where things can get kind of fishy. You have to be able to stay the course, do with what got you there.
All right, I'm going to speculate. I think you're right about Stewart. I think he has three. Montilla, I only had for one, and now he has three after that last one. And he's wearing twos, 22. Stewart is two. I think there was an error there. So I think it's Stewart with three. Montilla now with three. And that foul that was in question was actually Montilla's second, not Devontae's fourth.
Nice little block by Stewart playing aggressive regardless. And now both sides are a little helter-skelter trying to make some things happen. Wide open in the corner, McDonald.
Luckily, it went a little bit long because nobody covered him. Espinal, all alone. And he draws the foul.
Great job. That was a little game of cat and mouse.
Yeah.
Jaden tried to get out a little bit. And McGarry kind of slowed down for a second to try. He wanted to try and pin that against the backboard. And by doing so, fouled Espinal. That was a nice little cat and mouse game by both players.
McGarry gonna get chased from the game. That's his third foul. They're gonna bring in Dominic Taylor, who hasn't, I don't think he's been in the game yet. He has no points. If he has been in for any minutes, it was few and far between.
That play right there is what you talk about quite often. Let him go, don't give
right.
the and one. And, you know, the highlight culture that we live in, he was trying to pin that against the backboard, LeBron James style, and it backfired. Now he's going to sit.
Yeah. He says, I got the height. I'm going to get there. That looked almost like a travel, close to it. But, I mean, Espinal had such a gap ahead. He had a stride and a half ahead. Just give up the two. So now you're back down by 20 because it was a three-point play.
And after a couple weak possessions by Durfee, that was just what they needed.
Mm-hmm.
Great job collapsing.
I think there was a fingertip on that by Lucas. He came flying in. Oh, he lost it. I was just going to say, that would have been a great move if he got around. He left the ball behind. Beautiful take to the basket by McDonald.
Very quick move right there. I don't know if Mike, great pass.
And one.
Eric Lucas is really having a good game today, doing a lot of positive things. That's a great dump off for the layup. Going back to McDonald, I'm not sure if my comp resonates with this generation, but there's a lot of Steve Nash in his game.
Mm-hmm.
Very herky-jerky. Maybe it's a little bit of the long hair and the quick pull-ups. But I'm very impressed with his gameplay. He's very quick.
Little bump, and Espinal's going to get the whistle. Yeah, I was going to say, did he get away with one? And the official saw it. It's his second, Durfee's sixth foul. So after no fouls in the first quarter, 12 fouls over the last 12 minutes of play.
Everything always tends to even itself out.
Doesn't it?
Lamar back in for Lucas. Just giving Lucas a quick breather.
Out of play.
Somerset staying packed in.
This is a great crowd here tonight.
Both sides, Somerset brought a nice crowd.
It's just nice to see, you know, a fairly full gym here. You had the girls' game last Friday, an 8-0 girls' team against New Bedford, and this place was barely a quarter full. And it said, sheesh, where are all the fans? Lamar. Corner three is good from the bench. Lamar with another long ball.
Lamar has a very nice release, nice soft touch. He's been a real asset for Durfee this year. He's having a great season.
Spark plug, that's what we're going to call him. Great rebound there. Good reach from Dion in traffic, and he throws it away down the court. Oh! Taylor! From up above, over the head of Lamar to bat it away. That's a heck of a block.
That's a great block. But what Durfee's got to understand, knocked it out of bounds. They get the ball right here. Let's worry about, instead of worrying about getting blocked.
Had Lamar wide open in the corner. I don't think if he saw him, they were going to Espinal.
Late call there. I think that was an anticipated call.
You think?
I'm not sure. There was contact, and I think it was a little bit of a out-of-control dribble drive.
Durfee's seventh. Now Somerset is into bonus, and it's Montilla's fourth foul. He's got three in the four and a half minutes we've played in this third quarter.
Cameron
going to have to come out.
Cameron DeMello is going to come in and have to play some big minutes, just the same as Christopher Milford did. Cameron DeMello, a junior. I would call backup center. He's had a nice year coming off the bench. One of the few volleyball players on the team plays for me.
Medeiros 1-for-2 at the line. Somerset with just 7 points in this third quarter. They have not scored more than 10 in any given quarter tonight, even with the fast start in the first.
It probably won't happen because it's just something that's really hard to do. But, I mean, Durfee does have a chance to hold them on the double figures all for the first three quarters.
It's crazy. This is, you know, I know Somerset's missing shots, but Durfee's defense has not given them any room. And I truly believe that's a big factor here. Lamar off the glass. Contested shot. Gets it to go. 8 points for Lamar off the bench.
Another great pass. With a leak out,
getting easy opportunities. Another steal by Durfee. Durfee's flying up the floor right now.
He got there, and that's close to travel. Taken away. A couple extra steps maybe for Lamore, and the foul called against Simmons. It'll be his third.
It's amazing the pep in the step that you get when you start seeing a couple shots falling. And Durfee's a more than a couple shots by this point right now, but you start seeing the intensity pick up.
1-1 here.
Simmons with his third.
.46-19. First shot good. And Medeiros will take another.
Eric Lucas coming back into the game. Good minutes by Jahlil Simmons. When he's locked in, he does a lot of good things on the floor. He's very fast, very strong.
Both shots good from Medeiros that time. 3 for 4 on the night. All coming here in this third quarter.
Somerset finally extends their defense up a little bit. Looks like a little bit of a junk zone to be 2-2-1. Durfee breaks it easy.
Stewart looking for room. Out to Lucas. Sets for three, no good. And a foul before the ball came back. And I think that's against Durfee. It's going to be another 1-1. Durfee's ninth foul. We're not even done with three quarters here.
And who was the foul called on? Was it on Lamore? A loose ball away from the basket? Nope, Cameron DeMello.
It's not on Sarri. That was a mistake. Not on Sarri.
It was on Cameron DeMello.
Yeah. Three is good for Medeiros. And Medeiros with 13 points for Somerset. He's got more than half the team points.
Somerset in a high 1-2-2.
Yep. Oh, nice pass. Good feed outside to Lamore. They covered him quickly. Back to Lucas at the point.
With his 35-second shot clock, Durfee still has a ton of clock.
What a drive to the basket. Lamore up to 10.
Durfee out running again.
Espinal kicks it out. Lucas was bidding for three and he's got it. 51-24. Lucas
loose
up
ball.
To 10.
A lot of confusion with the referees. They're going to get together and try to talk this over. One's going one way with the others going the other. That looked like it was clearly Durfee ball. And it's great to see the genuine energy from the bench right now.
Yeah.
Guys really rooting each other on. This is big time confidence for Durfee at a moment where they really needed it coming into this game.
Four Hilltoppers into double figures tonight. Lamore just keeps adding.
Again, I'm going to keep saying the confidence. This is something Durfee really, really needs. Great jump the passing lane by Lamore. He's really going to bounce in his step right now. DeMello a little antsy down on the block, but he's playing hard. Good minutes off the bench from Cameron DeMello.
Team at the limit. 10 fouls for the Hilltoppers. They've maxed out with 36 seconds to go in the third. So free throws the rest of the way for the Raiders. McGarry at the line for two, hits the first.
Without looking at the stats, are we over 10 points for the quarter right now?
Yes, 13 for Somerset. They came in with 12 into the third. So they're up to 25 now, 13 so far here in the third. 1 second advantage on the, 1 second less on the play clock. Jump ball.
DJ Glover in for the first time for Durfee, number 25, his senior. We're going to get some good extended minutes. DJ plays real hard. Expect a lot of high energy from him. Somerset with that lob.
No good.
Right out of there.
Shot clock off. Basket is good. Acrobatic play from Lucas, who's gone off here in the second and third quarters.
Lucas and Lamore both with very good finishes. very good finishes around the basket. They're not big, and those are great finishes as Cameron DeMello picks up his third right away.
Just put it in perspective here. 30-point lead for Durfee. More shots for Somerset. Stewart with 5, but Espinal with 13. Lucas with 12. Lemoore with 12. Simmons with 11. Talk about spreading it around.
Balanced score and wins basketball games.
Uh-huh.
This isn't the NBA where you're going to have one guy go for 50. Balanced score and wins ball games. When everybody gets a chance to contribute.
Coach said that players have gotten a little bit selfish with the ball. Well, tonight, that's not the case. Lemoore with 14 points. 11 of those 14 in the third. And for Durfee, it's a 19-point third quarter. They lead it 57-26.
It's natural, you know, we live in this world, the highlight culture, and it's natural to want to score a lot of points and be the man, but for success, when you're able to spread things around, that's when good things happen, and this is a perfect example of that right now. You just read off that. That's great.
It's unbelievable. It's a great line. It's a game that the Hilltoppers should win, should come back with a chip on their shoulders, and yeah, absolutely. They need this, and it's going to feel good.
Yeah, Durfee has the opportunity if closing out the fourth quarter. 6-4 going into the halfway point. You know, you look at the positives, there's a ton. You know, you're ahead of the game. There's some games that you dropped that you clean up a few things that usually take care of itself in the second half of the season. And, you know, we're looking at a playoff berth. You know, you don't qualify for the state tournament in December.
No.
And I think a lot of teams walk into basketball practice the Monday after Thanksgiving and expect to qualify for the tournament that week. It takes a long time. You have to go through peaks and valleys. You have to go through tough stuff. And Durfee's showing that they can come out of some tough stuff.
I was thrown away looking for Milford. We also have Ben Cherry into the game. And who else did I see?
DJ Glover. Lamore.
Yeah,
Eric
Glover's
Lucas.
Still out. That's what I was going to say. Glover's still out there as well. So a couple starters now out of the game. I would imagine with the lead the way it is, you may not see any of the other starters back into this one before the end of the night. Might as well rest them.
Well, this is a great opportunity for some guys on the bench to get some extended playing time. In the course of a season, guys work hard at practice. Everybody's making sacrifices, going to Saturday morning practices, late nights. You know, this is a nice reward on these opportunities to get guys out there and get some extended minutes.
Lost his footing there. That should have been a travel. Glover with the foul. Durfee maxed out. I think if we were really counting past 10, Durfee's at about 12 or 13 fouls right now in the second half. Two shots for Finlaw. Hits the first.
You're definitely seeing this area right here. I think Jason Tatum has made the number zero cool.
Yeah.
High school kids are wearing it now.
Right.
Although double zero. And there's not one kid in this gym would understand the Robert Parrish reference, but nonetheless.
Cherry for three. Oh! Knocks it down. Welcome to the game, Ben. 60 points for the Hilltoppers tonight.
Cherry can shoot the ball. He's only a sophomore. He's got a very bright future. The basketball program, great athlete, great student.
Three on the other side from Dion.
He is a Mr. Kelly advisee, I would say. He's in my advisory. Great student, great kid. He's got a very bright future, Durfee Athletics. Another opportunity in the corner.
From the other side, no good. Skips off the rim, but had a good look at it.
Cherry can shoot the ball. He's gonna find minutes this season. Still early. Milford with a great rebound.
Down the court to Lemoore. Waits on it. Oh, what a shot! You kidding? Oh my gosh. I don't think people realize how difficult a shot that just was.
I am so impressed with Levante Lamore as just a bucket getter, as the kids would say.
Yeah.
He's a scorer. He puts the ball in the basket, and, man, they come quick. And I know he did this at the Bishop Conley game early in the year that I didn't do, but
right.
They come quick. He sees the hoop, and he just gets things going. And Espinal is going to go in.
Wow.
Coach DeCruz, he was hot. Had to let him. I would have let him go, Coach DeCruz, but I've been in that spot before.
I'm surprised he's back in, honestly. I didn't think we'd see.
But Lamar is getting things going.
Mm.
Let him go a little bit.
That's no good. I'm surprised that like Espinal's back in. I didn't think we'd see any of the starters. I was waiting for Lucas to get pulled. Lucas takes a shot, no good off the back of the rim. To Glover it goes. Goes into the paint, sends it off the back of the iron, no good. Fed up the court. Lucas is there to intercept. Passing.
Great pass.
Sherry. Oh, it doesn't go. Flipped away by Milford. And now McDonald down the court. Loses it. Oh, it's kept in. Lucas does it again. Airborne flip back inbounds and a foul the other way. Holy cow.
It's always great to see these guys, maybe aren't full rotational players or minutes differentiate from game to game, but it's great to see these guys coming in here and playing really, really hard. You know, that's just a test to the culture and the program, where this isn't, we're not going to just go three-point line to three-point line. Guys are coming in and trying to make plays. That's great.
Glover at the free throw line. He misses the first. He's had very few minutes tonight, not a lot of opportunities. Trying to make the most here as he hits the line. So missing the first, he'll take a second.
Going back to the Espinal thing, still being in the game.
Hmm.
He's a primary ball handler.
Right.
So at the very least, you just need to kind of settle things down. You don't realize when you don't have a primary ball handler in there how important it is. And you know, my guess would be that just to have things settled down.
Thrown away, and Dion just puts his head down. Lucas, who picked it off, goes coast to coast. Three on the other side, no good. As that one right off the rim and out of play. 5:07 left in this one. 66-31. Hilltoppers not letting off the loud pedal.
Durfee definitely, you can tell, took the first loss of the season to these guys. Very personal.
Glover from three. 4-3 from downtown.
Glove is flying with a lot of energy. A lot of energy in the game.
Sullivan into the game for Somerset. Gets in the book. A non-starter listed as a center. Espinal, no good.
Milford with a great rebound.
Glover to Sherry.
Great with Durfee. They're still running their stuff right now. It's not one pass shot or chucking threes. They're running their stuff a little bit.
Espinal pokes it. Foot race with McDonald. No good. Glover there for the putback. Doesn't get it. Second chance. It does go. Glover with a quick 6 points here in the fourth off the bench.
Glover right now, assuming he plays these four, he's going to find himself in the double figure game.
Another steal. Numbers. Espinal takes it himself. And a timeout for Somerset.
Durfee really pouring it on
wow.
right now. This is big for Durfee right now. Confidence, seeing the ball get into the basket, different guys getting into the scoring column, and avenging what, you know, a lot of people said was it Durfee's best effort last month. And you play these local rivalry games, people take it personal. And Durfee's done a really good job. And specifically, you're going to think they've done this in three quarters because they didn't do much in the first.
No, they really didn't. I mean, not until the end of the first, but there still wasn't much. A 40-point lead here with less than four to go. While we have a second next week, Fred TV coverage continues. We got a pair of boys' games, one from Diamond on Wednesday, 6:30 start. The Upper Cape Cod Tech Rams coming into the James T. Ashley Gymnasium And then we're back here Thursday for BR against the Hilltoppers. 6:30 start for now, that one as well.
Now, is Durfee on the road on Friday? Is that why we don't have a game Friday? Or is this just one of those weird gaps in the schedule that usually tends to happen at the end of January?
Durfee's playing Saturday.
Snowden.
That's weird. So Thursday, Saturday. Very interesting.
Great pass. Simmons leaked out. Haven't been where Coach Slade has been before. This is one where the clock does not seem to be moving.
No.
When all you want to do is move 3.5 minutes is still a long time, especially with guys right now that are really trying to make the most of their minutes. You know, it's tough in these situations. You know, you don't take your foot off the gas. Some of these guys only get these 3 minutes, and they work hard. It's really hard. It's not running the score up. It's guys playing hard. And I've been on both ends. It's you just want the clock to go, and it ain't.
Offensive foul.
You look up, and it looks, if you're Coach Slade, it looks like it's going up. Glover bringing the ball up for Durfee. Josh Sandin into the game. A chuck from the corner. Glover just playing hard right now, trying to get to the basket. With the deflection. Hoyle with the miss. Simmons still going. And a jump ball, probably one of those calls just to slow the pace down. Somerset trying to make anything happen right now. They've emptied their bench as well.
Another three for Hoyle, who just came into the game. So he's had two from downtown.
Somerset's in the same position as Durfee. These guys are trying to make the most of their extra time. Marcos Brazoban in the game for Durfee. Sandin brings the ball up. Taking a little bit of clock, Durfee is right now. Now they're not so fast to get shots up. 14 on the shot clock for the Hilltoppers. Sherry in the corner for three.
Sherry!
Buries another one. Great offensive possession for Durfee. Sixth man getting into it a little bit.
Another three for Hoyle.
Great job by him coming in, making the most of his minutes. Back-to-back threes. Sherry trying to get busy from the corner again. He's had a little more success from the right-sided corner.
Nice move there by Brazoban. Sherry to Simmons. 30 seconds remain in Durfee's sixth victory on the season. A statement game against a rival here. Sure, it's a lower division team. It's not conference, but this is a big win for the Hilltoppers.
Unbelievable effort by Durfee, considering the tough start in the first quarter. Everybody getting involved, everybody playing hard, genuine enthusiasm from the entire roster. Again, you said that this was a statement game. I think they took it a little personal with their performance a month ago. Great way to come out of that. Durfee playing hard right to the buzzer.
not making anything easy for Somerset.
78-42, a good old-fashioned beatdown here. Blowout win for the Hilltoppers, one that they desperately needed. A statement game. A great atmosphere tonight here in the gym. Fantastic win for the Hilltoppers. They really needed this one.
Yeah, great atmosphere. It's great that this has kind of become the it thing to do again for both communities. A lot of the student population for both schools here, the way it should be.
Well, folks, we appreciate you tuning in tonight. It was a fun one here. We haven't seen an offensive shootout like this for Durfee in a long time. What a good performance. Again, you know, a true blowout victory for the Hilltoppers and a good bounce back. It keeps them above 500 at 6-4. And looking at the schedule ahead, for Somerset, they will be playing next on Tuesday on the road at Wareham. Next Friday on the road at New Bedford Volk, and then the following Tuesday at Case on the road. This is the first of four straight road games for the Raiders before they come home in February. For Durfee, they will be at Braintree on Monday, and then back home here for two. The BR game on Thursday and Snowden on Saturday will be here next Thursday for BR. Hope you'll join us then for more live coverage. Until then, folks, for our crew tonight, Zach Souza and Daniel Keating on camera, my broadcast partner, Brendan Kelly. I'm Evan Massoud. Enjoy a great weekend.